Most of us will have at least 2 major surgeries during our lifetime. This is a fact of life. This was published by the Lancet report along with the World Health Organization, and this is something very, very scary. In fact, surgery itself is scary, right? We have all been on either this side of the door or the other, right? There is a sense of fear, apprehension, and unpredictability when it comes to surgery. And that's why it's very important to know more about it. But because it's a very serious topic, I want to talk about surgery through an analogy, through a story, the story of the 3 musketeers, right? And we're going to talk about the 3 musketeers of the operating room, the surgeon, the robot, and the AI. We're going to understand how robotics and artificial intelligence are changing and will change our lives in the future. My name is Saurya Mishra, and it's amazing to have all of you here. The story of surgery is almost 2,600 years old, and there cannot be any talk about surgery without mentioning Sushruta, the father of surgery. In fact, the earliest known medically relevant procedures were carried out by Sushruta in Varanasi in 600 BC. Now, these were some of the surgical instruments that he used. These have been found in the Sushruta Samhita. These are modern surgical instruments. Now, it is a matter of pride, but if you really look at it, not a lot changed in over 2 millennia. But things are changing now, and that's why it becomes very important to know more about what all is happening. It's time to bring to the stage our first hero, the surgeon. Now, a surgeon is probably the most skilled professional we humans have. But what makes a surgeon? What are his capabilities, his characteristics? What are his roles? A surgeon has an extensive amount of clinical knowledge. They understand the body inside and out. They know where everything is and how all of them play together in this beautiful harmony we call the human body. He's also creative. The creativity side of a surgeon comes because just knowing is not enough. To be able to plan around it, to be able to create creative solutions is extremely important for a surgeon. A surgeon also needs to have excellent execution skills. Performing a surgery is a very, very physical demanding task. To be able to stand and to operate and to keep on going and going and going, right? And to be able to do very precise movements. And finally, a surgeon is also a team leader. A surgeon is a project manager. In an operating room, he is the conductor who orchestrates the whole, you know, the whole orchestra. But just like every hero, our surgeon is also a human. And humans have drawbacks and limitations. We humans are not the best creatures, right? We have limitation of vision. Our human eye can only perceive a certain wavelength in the entire electromagnetic spectrum. The ability to magnify of our eye is pretty limited. There is the limitation of the human body. The size of the human body is something that stops surgeons from doing very, very procedures which can be done through very thin surgical instruments inside the body. There is the limitation of precision. Our human body is built in a way that, you know, we cannot hold our hand steady for a very long time. It will start vibrating. That affects the quality of surgery. There is the limit of endurance. How long can you stand? How much can you perform? Can you do 5 2-hour procedures in a single day? And finally, there is this limitation of data processing as well. Our brains are limited. We can hold and process only few amount of data in a certain period of time. And this is where our second hero enters, the surgical robot, the loyal assistant to our surgeon. Now, there are many kinds of surgical robots, and this is something extremely exciting because I work in the same field. A surgical robot is nothing but something, and what you see on your screen is something known as a soft tissue surgical robot. It enables the surgeon to be able to be virtually telepresent inside the body of the patient. So without having to make massive incisions on the body, it allows them to perform amazing surgeries and with very fast recovery times, and so that you can go home after a couple of days of a successful surgery. It enables the surgeon with a better vision, so they can see better into what is happening, right? it enables surgeons to perform surgeries in a very natural way instead of being in a very unergonomic way and standing and operating, right? It enables surgeons to have dexterity and precision, which is sub-millimeter level, which is something that the human body on its own cannot do. And finally, there is the aspect of the machine in the middle. Now, this is very important. Just like we see autonomous vehicles on the road right now, or integration of artificial intelligence into driving technology, the same is about to happen to surgery as well. And therefore, the machine in the middle approach to surgery has started. But does it mean that AI is going to take over everything? No, let's understand a little more about what exactly the AI is. This is our third hero. So, an artificial intelligence is ultimately defined as the understanding of intelligent behavior and thought and its implementation on machines. To put in very simple words, these are machines that can think, learn, and answer, and keep doing this over and over and over again, which allows these systems to become infinitely more intelligent and to keep on evolving and developing and getting better and better. But does it mean, and this is a difficult question, is AI the new surgeon? The short answer is no. And the long answer is long. So, you see, in all AI is not built the same. There are different levels of artificial intelligence that happens, and we're going to talk a little bit about that. And I call it the levels of autonomy. The lowest level of autonomy is known as supervised autonomy. This is where the robot does or the machine does very simple tasks, but is always guided by its user. The best example is cruise control in your cars, right? The next level of autonomy is known as shared autonomy, also known as task autonomy. Here, the robot does a little more activity. You don't have to do too much, but you still have to monitor it. And the best example for this is advanced drive assistance systems, or the automatic driving cars that we have on our roads. The third level of autonomy, and this is one of my favorite levels, is known as conditional autonomy. What this means is that the robot will be able to do, or the machine will be able to do, almost everything that is expected of it, but you sometimes have to get it out of the soup. And the best example is a robotic vacuum cleaner. Right? So it will be able to map out your home, it will be able to clean it and charge itself, but if it gets stuck on the rug, or gets trapped in its own wires, or gets attacked by a cat, you will have to come and save it. The fourth level of autonomy is known as high autonomy. This is where the user cannot directly communicate, or it's not possible for them to directly control the system. And the best example are Mars rovers, moon rovers. And ultimately, this brings us to the final level, and this is the holy grail, all full autonomy. There are no concrete examples of this. This is a system which completely controls itself, right? When it comes to surgical robotics, we are here right now. And we still have a long, long way to go. But that does not mean that we are not doing some amazing things. This is a surgical robot which is performing an operation of the eye, at the back of the eye, on the retina, through a hole which is 1 millimeter in width on the front of the eye. This is a surgical robot that is able to identify what kind of tissues does it encounter during a surgery, which makes oncosurgery or surgery of cancer very, very, very effective. This is a beautiful example because this is a tele-controlled surgical robot. And a surgery is happening on one end of the Atlantic Ocean, being controlled from the other end. And of course, we all know with the advent of 5G technology, this is going to become a reality very, very soon. In news recently was the brain-computer interfacing. We all know about that. This was achieved through a very specially designed robot, which implants a chip in the back of the head. And finally, we are also able to do surgeries of the lungs to be able to fight lung cancer, for example, without making a single incision on the human body. Now, while all of this is happening, there are some realizations as well, right? Less than 3% of all surgeries that can be done through robotic procedures are being done by robotic procedures. More than half of the population of the world still does not have access to proper surgical care. And this exactly is the intent of us robotic scientists, surgeons, doctors, technologists all around the world. How do we solve this problem? Which brings me back to the beginning of the problem, the three musketeers. Now, why three musketeers? I think this is one of my favorite analogies. I'm the novel of Alexandre Dumas. The surgeon is very similar to Athos. He is the leader, he is intelligent, he has a lot of experience, people respect him. The robot is Porthos, epitomed by strength, endurance, and very loyal to Athos. And finally, the spirit of Aramis is in the AI. Intelligent, conflicted, but at the same time dealing with hundreds and thousands of choices in order to find a solution. And of course, with an enigmatic charm. So just like our three musketeers in Dumas' novel move towards a single intent, the three of our musketeers also move towards a single intent. The intent is to remove fear from surgery altogether. We hope that one day surgery would become just a fact of life, that we will not be afraid of it, that more people will have access to it. And we hope that one day we can alleviate pain, illness, and suffering. Thank you.